Hi, this is the Philosophical Angle Program, and I'm your host, Chris Angle. I'm the author of four books on philosophy, one of which is the Philosophical Equations of Economics. These books are available free for viewing online at www.philosophypublishing.com. Also, actually probably one of the books that is more appropriate for the last two episodes is The Nature of Aesthetics, which we're also going to be discussing. Along with me is my panelist, Rick Samuelson. He's co-host and a colleague, and he's out in the West Coast. He's a venture capitalist there, and Rick graduated from Yale and Wharton. And good to see you, Rick.
Good to see you. Merry Christmas.
The purpose of the philosophical angle is to examine the nature of the concepts being used in current media. But this week we're going to actually discuss not so much a concept as a subject, and the subject is the Russian influence on the news. And it'll be our second episode on this, because we discussed this last week. And it's incessantly in the news, and as we've seen, it's on every day, and so we've got to discuss it just a little bit more, because the core or essential core of this subject is the influence is coming from an international source. Everybody's complaining that the election was influenced by Russia, and that it is unfair, and that it is unfair that the election was being influenced by an international source, and so why is that? Why should they call for this Russian influence if it were to be? So we're going to actually assume, for the purposes of this program, that today's discussion that the Russian actually did influence it, and it's not. It may have or may not have, but we have to ask ourselves, why are they screaming unfair? And you have to consider that Hillary sold her future influence for donations to her nonprofit, which turned out to be a personal slush fund, and this is obviously wrong. So I don't see why they should complain, they being the left, the Democratic left, why everything is unfair in this. What is the influence? And you have to consider, what is the influence in its essence? And that's really just knowledge and information coming from without the outside the United States. If you've got the New York Times writing about the election, that's influence, that's knowledge and information coming from the New York Times to its readers within the United States. But what about sources outside the United States? Are they not allowed to write and send information into the United States? I would think that the voting public would want to receive all knowledge and information, no matter what its source, whether it's coming from inside the United States or outside the United States. And of course, it should receive all worldwide information from whatever its source. It should take in whatever available information. It gives a better informed voter. So I still ask, why is this unfair? Just because it comes from without the United States. This information and knowledge is probably because it was detrimental, and that's probably why they're screaming that it is unfair. So the Democratic left wants to limit your knowledge and information because it wants to eliminate that which is outside the sphere of the United States. Actually, really what they want is being outside the sphere of what they can control. That might be detrimental to their ideas. And if knowledge is limited, and if you anytime you limit knowledge, you limit freedom. And further, and really conversely to that, we can actually refer to our own culture historically. We can go right to the Bible and in John 8, verse 32, where it says, "Then ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." And I think the founding fathers knew that knew of this, and of course they put this type of thinking into the Constitution, into the amendments of the Constitution, probably the most important amendment of all. But the progressive, utopian, socialist Democrats are really not for the for free speech, it seems. They are essentially they are against free speech if they don't like at least that which is detrimental to their ideas. They would they it doesn't look like they are for free speech. And speaking of being unfair and untoward and toward untoward influence to their electioneering, how about the theft of the Democratic nomination of Hillary from Bernie? In order to be truly fair, the election should have been between Trump and Bernie. All this Democratic claptrap is really to delegitimize the election of Donald Trump. But the Democrats have already delegitimized the election with the nomination of Hillary because really she stole it from Bernie in very unethical way. And so we're at this point we're going to ask Rick what he thinks of all this. Rick, what do you think?
Well, I think the most hilarious element in it all is the Democrats don't seem to be questioning the authenticity of the various leaked emails. And as you rightly point out, they're embarrassing, particularly in respect of the DNC's only election to Hillary. The fact that Democrats are not supportive of Christians and, in fact, are dismissive of them. Is this really new information? It's part and parcel of observed behavior. It's something everyone knew and, Democrats routinely denied, but based on their behavior, it's clear what was actually happening in respect of their pursuit of pushing Christianity out of the public sphere, and in the way the primary was conducted, by the Democratic National Party. What's interesting is their main argument seems to be that, emails weren't leaked from the Republican National Committee, and therefore the Russians were trying to swing the election in favor of Donald Trump. That is possible. It's possible that the Russians couldn't break into the Republican National Committee emails. It's possible that there were no similarly embarrassing emails to reveal to the public. I mean, there are a raft of possibilities here. But most amusing of all, supremely amusing, is that the Democrats don't contest the content of the emails. I mean, this is absolutely hilarious.
Right.
And so I guess that would be the first point. The second point is the electors have spoken. Donald Trump will be the president. All of these machinations are now a matter of history because they cannot change the outcome. The deed is done. Donald Trump will be president, for better or for worse. And as you rightly point out, everything else is theater. Theater with the obvious intention of undermining his status, his credibility, his image within the United States and without the United States as well. As far as the Russians are concerned, if I were in Putin's shoes, and if it could be proven that the Russians were entirely responsible for all this, given the reaction of the Democrats, I'd be sorely tempted to do more of it, particularly given that it's the one thing that's moved Barack Obama to actually say anything resembling something aggressive about Russia. I mean, Syria is allowed to fester and die on the vine. Aleppo is basically destroyed, and he's more concerned about the fact that the Russians have hacked the Democratic National Committee, and he wants to take, you know, harsh steps. I mean, it's tragicomic, because here's a leader who's so obviously more concerned about the politics surrounding all this than actually doing something on the world stage, doing something concrete, doing something virtuous. And there you have it. It's an appropriate exclamation point for the style of his entire presidency. Politically orientated, but when it comes to dealing with the facts on the ground around the world in a constructive way, ineffective.
Yeah, an interesting point that you just brought up about virtue, your actions being virtuous as opposed to your actions being political. And obviously, the way to become a great president is to follow virtue throughout all of your actions. And I don't think that this president has done that. And that will be a good discussion for the future. Rick, last point before we conclude.
Well, in that vein, I think it was John Adams who said, this republic is founded by persons dedicated to virtue, and it is an appropriate form of government for no other.
Excellent.
I'm paraphrasing.
Excellent point. Okay, thanks very much, and we'll see everybody next week on the Philosophical Angle program.
Thank you. Merry Christmas.